When it's Leeds, I get the 7:05 from King's Cross. It's a 6.5 minute walk to the tribunal, which just leaves me long enough for a latte at the station, as long as the train's not late.
Big issue, look.
Oh, sorry, no time.
As barristers, we deal with people in extreme situations. They're not always at their best. We see them on what might turn out to be the worst day of their lives.
Ah, you must be...
Susanna Andrews. Susie.
Rebecca Nyman. Hi. Now, your solicitors briefed me. There's just a few things that would be good to go through together.
Is there anywhere here I can smoke?
Afraid not.
Of course not.
Nervous?
Keyed up. Raring to go. Go on then, what do you need to ask me?
Are we still waiting for your doctor's statement?
I've got it, but I don't want it going in as evidence.
Well, why on earth not? We really need it.
No.
Well, we have to show what losing this job cost you. It's like judo. You need to use your weakness against them.
And if I'm not willing to do that?
Well, it might stop you winning. Or it might mean you win, but you get less money. They need to know. Susie.
It's all about how I fell apart. I didn't want to give the bastards the satisfaction.
Thanks.
Anything else?
Oh, you've got a good case. Don't be tempted to over-egg it.
Meaning?
Give it to them straight. A lot of this, well, it's your word against his. So the tribunal have to decide who they believe. It's all about establishing your credibility. Watch your body language. Look them in the eye. Don't mumble.
You don't have to tell me how to behave in the witness box. It goes with the job.
You'll find it rather different when it's closer to home.
Okay.
Charlie Haynes, the police's barrister, is a bit of a thug. Don't let him rattle you.
Do you want to swear or affirm?
I'll affirm.
Read aloud. From the card on the table.
I solemnly and sincerely declare and affirm that the evidence which I shall give to the tribunal will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
Could you tell the judge and the wing members of the tribunal your name and occupation?
Ms. Suzanne Andrews, I'm... Well, before I was made redundant, I was a chief inspector in the East Yorkshire Police Force.
I want to begin, Ms. Andrews, by taking you back to your career before you joined the East Yorkshire Force.
Sir, I'd question the need to canter through the claimant's entire life story.
Thank you, Mr. Haynes. Miss Nyman?
To establish she was a high flyer in the Met before relocating to East Yorkshire, sir.
With the greatest respect, my friend has already submitted Miss Andrews' CV in the bundle. Page 177-182. We don't contest her stellar career before coming north. The issue is what happened after.
Mr. Haynes has a point. Perhaps we could move on.
Sir, in your first 6 months in East Yorkshire, how would you describe your relationship with Roy Eadley?
He was my boss.
Your personal relationship?
Good, on the whole. He was supportive. I got on well with him.
Did the relationship extend outside the office?
In the job, well, it's not just a job, is it? It's all-consuming. And the stuff that happens, not all the time, but it happens, that you can't really take outside, for reasons of confidentiality, but also because it would be uncomfortable. The stuff people don't want to hear, even when they ask you about it, believe me, they really, really don't want to hear. So, your team are, and should be, more than just work colleagues.
Did you ever see Mr. Eadley outside of work?
Well, yes. We'd have a drink after work. Then, one weekend I bought a wardrobe in one of those furniture warehouse places at the edge of town, and he helped me lug it up the stairs into my flat. I mean, I just moved from London. I didn't know a soul up here. It was good to make a friend.
Would you say he was supportive or not?
Well, sure. But it was a two-way street.
Meaning?
I gave him support too. He was having a hard time with his teenage daughters. Emily, the oldest one, got expelled from school for... Well, I don't want to go into it here, but you know, it's tough being a copper's kid. Their mother wasn't on the scene, so Roy felt it was good for them to get some female company. He lives in Little Mitcham, just west of the city. We used to go fell walking. I had a lot of time for his kids. I still do.
Can I take you to page 2 of your witness statement, paragraph 11? These are examples of jokes that were made in the office in your hearing.
Yes.
Can you read out the first one on the list?
What do you say to a woman with two black eyes? Nothing. She's been told twice already.
Were these jokes made to you?
No. They were called across the office to other members of the team. But the desks are all quite close, so it was impossible not to hear them.
If they were called across the office, how do you know they weren't also addressed to you?
It was my impression these jokes were quite deliberately not addressed to me. The aim of them was to exclude me.
We deal in questions of fact here, Ms. Andrews, not feelings. What evidence do you have that these jokes were intended to exclude you?
The content. The content was clearly designed to make me feel uncomfortable. What do you call a woman with one black eye? A quick learner. Why else would you tell a joke like that?
Then we have the incident at the Christmas party, which you describe in your statement on page 7. After that, did things get worse, or did they remain the same?
They got worse.
In what way?
It was toxic. Work became a toxic place to be. The team stopped talking to me, outside what they needed to do for work. I'd become invisible.
Can you be specific?
No one asked me to the pub. For example, the snack run. Tommy, who was the junior member of the team, used to go out to the corner shop every day to get everyone their chocolate fix. In January, he just stopped coming by my desk.
Did you say anything to him?
At first, I'd say, Tommy, what about me? Or, Tommy, oi, over here, I'll have a Kit Kat since you're asking. But after a week or so, I just thought, sod it, started buying my own.
And then, on the 23rd of March, there was the first incident you reported to HR. Can you describe to us what happened?
I had a case fall apart that morning. My witness had gone AWOL. A very unpleasant man who we'd devoted a lot of time and energy to putting away walked. I was in a filthy mood. I got into the office around lunchtime. Tommy made some crack about sending a girl to do a man's job, and I lost it.
What did you say?
I can't remember exactly. I shouted at him. I told him where to stick it. Then I got outside for some fresh air and a fag. When I got back, there was a used tampon on my desk.
Who do you think was responsible?
I'm not sure Tommy would have had the balls. But whoever it was, they all knew. And no one caught my eye. No one said a word.
What did you do?
It really... it felt so personal. It felt like it was from all of them. I phoned HR, made an appointment for the next morning, then I cabbed it home. I was shaking. I didn't want to risk driving.
Can I draw your attention to Roy Eadley's witness statement, page 52, paragraph 3-6? Do you want a minute to refresh your memory of what he says there?
I remember it, thank you.
He says you were always treated with utter professionalism by him and the rest of his team.
He's lying.
So how would you describe Mr. Eadley's behaviour?
Well, it was mostly what he didn't do.
I'm not clear what you mean, Ms. Andrews.
They were his team. They were bullying me and he didn't call them on it. He turned a blind eye.
Can I draw the tribunal's attention to page 75 in the bundle? This is a list compiled by Miss Andrews of the cases she was allocated by Mr. Eadley during her 6 months at East Yorkshire. Can you summarise this table, Miss Andrews?
Before Christmas, I'm getting meaty, interesting work. Assaults, GBH, the occasional murder. As you can see here, after Christmas, the number of trivials in my caseload goes shooting up.
What do you mean by trivials?
Cases that eat up a huge amount of time and energy and don't amount to much. Noisy neighbours, shoplifting. I spent most of April tracking down a bloke who was cutting girls' hair on the bus without them noticing, that kind of thing.
But someone has to deal with those cases.
Yes, of course. And for the people involved, they can be very important.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.